Hello. Okay, next part I'm continuing with the types of consolidation. So consolidation, like I said earlier also, there are two types, primary and the secondary, and it happens almost immediately when all the water present in the pore is expelled out. So up to 90 to 95% of the total consolidation takes place because of the expulsion of pore water, and that is termed as the primary consolidation. And secondary consolidation is only the remaining 5 to 10% of the total settlement consolidation. That is because of simply the rearrangement or readjustment of the soil solids, and then because of also the expulsion of the adsorbed water. So adsorbed water is the water that is the thin film of water that is surrounding each and every soil particle, which are not free to move. So even in the long interval of time under the static constant loading, so because of under that does not come out immediately. So under constant loading, that adsorbed water which are not free to move, even that water will expelled out, and then the secondary consolidation happens. Okay, due to structural rearrangement and due to expulsion of adsorbed water, the secondary consolidation, which is 5 to 10% of total sediment. And here I've explained the difference between compaction and consolidation. Compaction is because of the dynamic loading, and it is steady static pressure. Because of steady static loading, it's a rapid phenomena, it's a slow process. It is measured in terms of dry density, that we have explained in terms of in that standard Proctor test, right? So dry density, and it is measured in terms of amount of settlement. And the compression of soil mass occurred here is called the initial compression, and here that occurs immediately after loading due to expulsion of water is called primary consolidation, and it is achieved by vibration or ramming or rolling, and it is achieved by overburden pressure for a prolonged period. It is affected by expulsion of air, and it is affected by expulsion of pore water. It is affected also mechanically also. The initial compression or compaction can happen due to rearrangement of solid structure or by adding admixtures also. Here it has to be the expulsion of water only. It can be when all the water is squeezed out, then only this consolidation is happening. Okay, and now next we go to the Terjaghi's one-dimensional consolidation theory. And in that, before we actually go to the theory, which was given by Terjaghi in 1923, he made certain assumptions, right? So assumptions are this. So first assumption is that soil is to be consolidated, should be fully saturated. He assumed that the soil, whatever is consolidated, when he explained this one-dimensional consolidation theory, it is assumed to be fully saturated. The soil mass should be homogeneous. Everybody knows, right, what is homogeneous. And the soil should be isotropic. Isotropic means soil properties of that particular soil should be same in all the directions. And another assumption is one dimensional. One dimensional means whatever the water is being expelled out, it happens only in vertical direction. Okay. And vertical flow may be one way or two way, that I'm going to explain just after some time. The change will happen only in depth. That means whatever the volume change is happening, that should happen only in the depth. Okay, so mainly because of reduction in depth, the volume should change. That means there should be no changes in the lateral direction of the soil mass. And the plastic rearrangement of the soil solid is considered. That means is ignored. That means when the plastic readjustment of soil solid happens, when the consolidation is secondary. So here secondary consolidation is ignored, not considered. So we are considering only about 90-95% of the consolidation that happens almost immediately after all the water in the pore has been expelled out. So we'll consider only the primary consolidation for this theory. And soil solids and water are both in, he assumed that both are incompressible. And here Darcy's law should be obeyed, that Q is equal to KIA or V is equal to KI, that relation should be applicable here. Permeability of soil particle here ignored. And the boundary condition should be free. That means whatever movement of water is happening, it should be free. So what is one way and two way? What flow means is actually, if we consider a soil mass that is existing in the site, it is compressed between, suppose if I assume that this soil layer is compressed between two sandy layer on top and bottom, then we can say that whatever water is present in the voice, will certain part of the water will expel out from the top and the certain part will expel out from the bottom, because it is porous on the top and also at the bottom. So we'll assume that laterally the soil is constrained or restrained. So the when the water will flow, then usually from the center of that depth, H naught, half the water from the top will expel out from the top porous part, porous or pervious layer, and the remaining 50% of water will expel out from the lower pervious layer. Okay, so if the drainage is available on the top and bottom both way, then that type of flow is called the two-way. Okay, two-way flow. That is called the drainage path. So drainage path is available in both the top and the bottom direction. So here the drainage path D is will be actually the half of the total depth of soil mass. That means effectively the water that has traveled from the middle to the top part and middle to the bottom part is only half the total depth. And when the one of the layer is here, the bottom layer, if I assume to be impervious, water is allowed to expel out only from the top pervious layer. So the water traveled the full, have to travel the full depth of H naught. So that is called the one-way drainage. Okay, and then the effective drainage path D will be the whole depth of the soil mass. Okay, so that is what the two-way drainage and the one-way drainage means. And that is what it also means, assumptions he made, the flow is one dimensional, means flow will happen only in the vertical direction. He assumed that laterally no flow is happening, or if the change is happening in the volume, that will be only in the vertical direction, and laterally they are not allowed to expand in the lateral direction. Okay, because laterally in the both lateral direction the movement is restrained, so that change also happen only in depth, and the movement of water will also be in the vertical direction. So expression for the Tajavis theory. So he assumed the soil mass here, okay, of height H naught, and then for the two-way drainage and one-way drainage, he this is the depth of soil mass, and if it's a two-way drainage, then it is sand and sand pervious layer on top and bottom. So the effective depth will be height half of the total depth. And it is one-way drainage, only the water is expelling, moving out from the upper pervious layer. So the effective drainage path will be the total height H naught. And he inserted the four piezometric tube, if we insert four piezometric tube on the side of the soil mass, just to measure the head of the water at each of these points, then it is seen that at the top, the movement of the water will be less, and more or less at the center the head of the water will be highest, okay, towards the center part of the soil mass the head of the water will be highest, and as we go again move down the head of the water will reduce. So if we draw the curve touching all the head in the four piezometric tube, then it will be of something like that parabolic shape, with the maximum value somewhere closer to the middle portion of the soil mass. And if we see for a one-way drainage, when the water is allowed to escape only from the top or only from the bottom, then as we go down, the head of the water available will be more. Okay, at the bottom, the head of the water available will be maximum. And as you go up, the head will gradually decrease. So the curve we get will be something like that. Okay, for the one-way drainage. So we consider that soil mass having a depth of Z, having the free boundary conditions, and vertically it is not restrained, it is restrained laterally, but vertically the changes or the flow is free. So U is the pore water pressure for this particular case, H is the hydraulic head, K is the coefficient of permeability, then I is the hydraulic gradient here, which is equal to do H upon del H upon del Z, and V is the velocity of the seepage water, and T is the instantaneous time. So under the load, excess pore water pressure to which the pore water is subjected is, you know, pore water pressure is equal to gamma W into H. Usually how we calculate the pressure for a soil mass of depth H and the unit of water is gamma W, then the pressure is gamma W into the head of water, right? So here we are calculating the pressure in the pore water, that is what the pore water is subjected to under the loading, that pore water pressure will be gamma W into H. From here we can find the head of the water, okay, U upon gamma W. Now we'll differentiate this equation partially with respect to depth of soil mass. We consider the depth as Z. Okay, here that S naught is considered as Z. So we differentiate that equation head of water partially with respect to the depth Z. So del H upon del Z is equal to del Z of that whole thing U upon gamma W. So one gamma W is constant, so we take it out. So inside the differentiation sign, it will be only del U by del Z. So that del H upon del Z is actually your hydraulic gradient I. Okay. Now again, since we know that soil mass is following the Darcy's law, so Q is equal to KIA we can take. Now if we divide that Q by the area, so that is Q is meter cube per second and divide by area meter square, so ultimately it will be meter per second, which is actually the velocity V. So that is equal to K into I. So from here V is equal to K into I, and I will put the value from that equation 1 upon gamma W to del U upon del Z. So we'll differentiate again this equation partially with respect to Z for the second time. So that becomes del V upon del Z is equal to K upon gamma W, both being constant. So this becomes square, okay? Del U square upon dz square. Del square U upon del Z square. So here del V upon del Z, it represents the rate of decrease of seepage velocity with the increase of time. Okay, when initially when we start the consolidation process, the pore water escaping rate of the pore water whatever escapes out from the soil mass is faster. But with the increase of time, as the more and more water is expelled out, the rate becomes less and less. So it represents that rate of decrease of seepage velocity with the increase of time. And del square U upon del Z square represents the rate of change of pore water pressure with respect to depth. Okay, with the change in depth. Because as the pore water is expelled out, the depth also keeps on reducing. So this is the variation of the rate of pore water expulsion with the change in the depth of the soil mass. So taking that continuity equation, Tarzaghi derived that above this equation 3 as this. Okay, so del U upon del T, this he derived as the continuity equation. From here he derived it as K upon gamma W into MV. He introduced certain constant term here by doing many consolidation tests, and that del square U upon del Z square, he kept it same. So that constant term he introduced, K upon gamma W into MV, he called that as the coefficient CV, which is actually the coefficient of consolidation. And then again, for that continuity equation, he gave the solution for this equation as U is some function of TV. Okay, so U, he said, it denotes the degree of consolidation, and TV denotes the factor called the time factor. Okay, so here that is the solution for the different continuity equation that the Tarzaghi has derived. So again, so since he has given that term, introduced that term, and he replaced all this term by a single word CB, that is what according to him is K upon gamma W into MV, he introduced one more term here. We already know what is K, right? That is the coefficient of permeability. And gamma W, we already know, unit weight of water. And MV is a new term he introduced here. That is the coefficient of volume compressibility. Okay, we'll be dealing with that afterwards. And small t is the time required for a particular consolidation at a given time. And small d, and here he introduced one more term, right? TV. So that he said that is equal to CV into T upon D square. CV is the same, that coefficient of consolidation. And T is instantaneous time, T. Whatever degree of consolidation we are measuring at that particular time is T. And D is that D, effective drainage path we are talking about, right? If it's a two-way drainage, that will be the half of the height of the total depth of soil mass. And if it is one-way, that will be simply the height, H naught. So that is the square of the effective depth. So he introduced the new term here, CV, then MV and TV, and then also degree of consolidation. You will be defining all this in the next video.